what a pleasure. Normally, I mean, on the stage like this, it should start by a joke. And the joke is, there is a rabbi, there is an imam, and there is a priest. But I won't tell the joke. Just maybe a few words of introduction. Aryeh already said a few words, but I understand that it's important for all of us to know who is on the stage today. So I need to put my glasses. So to start by Imam Mohammad Tawhidi, he's a senior Islamic scholar born in Iran, in Homs, Gum for the French. He's a senior imam and the current vice president of the Global Imam Council. And he was sworn in 22 after an incredible winning of 70% of the votes of the council, which has 1,400 members. This is really impressive. He was publicly ordained as an Islamic authority in the holy city of Qom in Iran in 2010. He holds a graduate diploma in strategic leadership, a master of Islamic studies, and second master in counterterrorism from Sydney, where he used to be before. And he's currently completing his doctoral degree. What you have to know is the fact that Daesh, ISIS, kidnapped and killed his uncle in 2015. And since then, he has dedicated his life to ideologically talking the spread of Islamic extremism and has delivered speeches at conferences, parliament, mosques, Islamic centers, churches, synagogues, temples, and universities across the Middle East, Europe, Americas, and Asia. And he was also recognized by the Senate of Canada in 2018, and was invited by the Prime Minister office in Hungary in 2019 to participate to a conference on Christian persecution on the Middle East. So definitely, he is the man to talk tonight. Haim Korsia, I mean, we have many people in France, we know who is Haim Korsia, but for the foreigners, he served as a rabbi in France, you know, as a chief rabbi in France for more than two decades. He was elected as a member of the Central Consistory, representing the Jewish congregations across the country. And I didn't know you hold a Master of Business Administration. Very interesting. But tonight we are not going to speak about business, but about the treatment of minorities in the Middle East. Patrick Prébois, Père Patrick Desbois, is a French priest of the Catholic Church. And he was a director of the National Service of the Bishops of France for relations with Judaism and consultant to the Commission of the Holy See for Religious Relations with Judaism. He chairs the Yahad in Unum Association, which conducts research in Eastern Europe on the victims, Jews and Roms, murdered by the Einsatzgruppen and other German units during the Second World War. And the association has collected more than 6,500 testimonies from neighbors and identified more than 2,700 execution sites. So thank you very much for being with us. And I would like to ask you, I mean, a few questions regarding the rights of minorities in the Middle East. First of all, I mean, let's work on other countries besides Israel. And maybe Imam Tawhidi, can you tell us a few things regarding the life of Shiites in Sunni countries and of Sunnis in Shiites countries?
Yeah, he's trying to get me in trouble.
I know.
Sunni-Shia conflict. But firstly, I want to thank Elnet, all of the governing board members for the invitation. It's my absolute honor to be here. And I am delighted to be on stage with eminent figures, the Honorable Rabbi and the dear father here. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I think the real question that people have is, what on earth am I wearing? And I like to get that out of the way. So this is the official uniform that Shia Muslim imams are ordained with. And the abaya that I'm wearing is an Arabic abaya, which signifies that I'm an Arab. You might see other imams who don't have these trimmings, and those are the Iranian abayas. Now that's out of the way. My dear brother, With regards to minorities in the Middle East, especially a country that I am originally from, Iraq, we have to define what minority means, because without defining it, it remains a noun. The usage we have now is that it is a terminology. And the best definition really I have seen is from the Italian jurist Francesco Capatorti, who says that a minority is a group of people whose population is inferior to the rest of the population and don't have a dominant power within that region, because minorities can also rule governments, such as in Syria when the Alawites are a minority and they rule the government. What we are dealing with in Iraq is a mistreatment of minorities, because the Iraq we have today is not the Iraq we had several decades ago. And I mean that not just politically, militarily, I mean that even socially. The influence of the regime on the other side of the border, the regime occupying Iran, shall I say, has turned Iraq into a governance that is a playground for the regime. And therefore, the Sunnis have been oppressed in Iraq. The Yazidis have been oppressed in Iraq. The same applies to the Sabians, who are of an Abrahamic faith as well, the Sabian Mandeans, and many other minorities, including the Kurds and other people of other faiths. If you go up to the north, then the Christians. And as you all know, there are only three Jews left in Iraq. So that is a massive question mark on the history, the bloody history of sectarianism that began with Muslims and then expanded to other figures. I want to conclude the question with the treatment of minorities in Iran. Iran really treats minorities in a very clever way. And it's a cunning way. I don't want to use the word clever here in a positive context. Iran has ceased oppressing its Jewish people in the meantime to be able to tell the world, see, we also have Jews. See, the Jews here are doing fine. Iran doesn't want you to speak about the nearly a million of Jewish people who had their lives robbed from them. Everything they owned, Iran stripped them from all of their rights. And by Iran, I mean the regime specifically, the terrorist cult ruling the beautiful country that has everything to offer humanity. The Shias in Iran are well off, except those who oppose the regime itself. The Sunnis face the same problems that the Sunnis face in Iraq, because Iran does not want Sunnis to gain power and then gain support from other Gulf countries that are mainly Sunni. So they focus on oppression, silencing any voice, whether Shia or Sunni, that is against them. And I think this is a topic that cannot be ignored, because when you point the finger at Iran and say, hey, listen, you're mistreating Jews and Christians, they say, no, we're not. We're fine. But if you say, hang on, you mistreat your own people in the same way, this destroys their credibility, and it allows you to open the conversation about other groups such as Jewish people as well.
Thank you. You mentioned the Yazidis. Père Desbois, vous avez œuvré énormément.
Yes, I know how much you've worked for the Yazidi recently. Could you say a few words about that?
2015, we are in Iraq with my organization. My organization is a silly name because it's called Yahad in Unum. So when you say to a Catholic, you say, what is Yahad? When you speak to a Jew, you say, what is in Unum? And when you speak to non-believers, they understand nothing. But we took this name. And so since 5 years, when I saw what happened to the Yazidi, we decided to work in Iraq, because after now nearly 20 years about Holocaust, we are specialists of mass shootings. So what happened for the Yazidi? The Yazidi are not Christian, and they are not Muslims. They never accepted to convert. They are like Zoroastrian. So when Abu Bakr Baghdadi began to arrive with his troop, with ISIS, he said immediately he will put them in slavery. And he used the same methodology everywhere. He surrendered the village. And he said, don't worry, It's only a changement of administration. Go in administration, you receive new paper. So the family at the end, they go to the building. Here, they close the door. Suddenly, they take out all the babies. All the newborn babies have been taken out and given to Islamic families in the middle of nowhere. Until now, the family don't find them. After, they say, we take all the males, and they will shoot them. And after, what they do, they want to buy virgins. They made a deal with the Sunnite groups around, and so doctors are coming inside, female doctor, to check which girl is virgin or not. And they will sell them by group, by 100, by 20, by 30. You must know now a girl who escapes now from ISIS, because ISIS is not dead, she has been sold between 25 times to 35 times. And she had forced pregnancy. So these people have been enslaved and converted, because the condition was you are Muslim or you die. They have been considered as kuffar. Kuffar, it means you are a maker, you are a non-believer, you are nobody. So what they did also is that they took all the young boys and they put them in special school, in Islamic school, in Mosul or in other cities, forbidden to remember your name, forbidden to speak your language, forbidden to remember your parents. And they brainwashed them so that these children became terrorists. So suddenly we had thousands of Yazidi brainwashed boys putting bombs and being candidate to be suicide bomber. We are trying, actually, we have four centers in Iraq to rehabilitate them. It's complicated. It's complicated because when a girl goes out now, because they go out from Syria or from Turkey, and she had been married 25 times, imagine the husband. Imagine the family. And also, the babies are not accepted, so they have to abandon their babies in Syria. For the boy, it's the most complicated. Because these boys have been trained to shoot. We have interviewed 400 people to work for justice. I interviewed a boy, he was 18 years. He has been enslaved when he was 12. He has killed minimum 700 people. He has been sniper. He has been beheader. He sent missiles. And in the middle of interview, you know what? I knew he said the truth because he was smiling the full interview. All that with camera. And so we try to rehabilitate them because sooner or late, these people will wake up. If we don't do the job, a new Islamist leader will say, hey, guy, remember, you were a sniper. Remember, you were a suicide bomber. Remember, you were somebody, and now you are nobody. So it's a question of security. And when I heard that ISIS now was making shootings in Israel, I remember how many Yazidi told me they have been sold to Palestinians.
Wow. Okay. Rabbi Korsia, maybe it's going to be faster because I'm going to ask you, what is the current situation of Jews in the Middle East except of the situation in Israel? Bien sûr.
Of course. Well, it's quite simple. There are none. Except for Iran, I like the definition the Imam gave us for the use of the Jews in Iran. They are used as a way to prove that there's still a community and that the state is open-minded. But in reality, the communities in Iran are scarce. There are a few Jews in the countries around Israel, in the Middle East. We take care of them. We still have relationships with them. But it is very complicated, and there is no organized Judaism anymore. And it is all the more sad, I want to say it, to Father Desbois, who is making wonderful work there. We need to protect diversity in the Middle East. We need all religions to be represented in the Middle East, Jews, Christians. And this is terrible because this is something we're witnessing in Europe as well. the situation of Jews in a given country is always a very good indicator of the health of a democracy. This is very important because in the French Arab World Institute, especially under Jacques Lang, which reminded us of what we had committed to do together, organizing an exhibition on the Christians in the Middle East and then in about the Jews in the Middle East. It was vital for us to do so, to remind everyone that there were Jews in Iraq, in Yemen, in Oman, in Khaybar, in Saudi Arabia, because these are my origins, and everywhere in the Middle East, not mentioning Iraq, where the Talmud is from. Let me circle back to something that is really moving to me, this diversity. But diversity also needs to be structured in Israel. Earlier, Abu Ghosh was mentioned. And when Eli Korsia, the president of the Central Commission, wanted to organize an event in Israel, he wanted to go to Abu Ghosh. This is a village where the mayor is a Muslim. We received the mayor in the convention, Father Jean-Marie Coudray. And when both are highlighting how crucial it is to understand that Israel is not an apartheid country, I want to mention the Ecclesiast for a foreigner to praise you, but not your voice. And the goal in Israel is to make sure that there is such diversity, because outside the country it is complicated, but we also need to take care of it in the country with all religions. And when Israel is taking care of it, it is doing so as a protector of all faiths and beliefs.
The current status of minorities there.
Very controversial. Where is this? Yeah, no, my view is very controversial, at least within my circles. Firstly, I'm a religious man. I look at everything firstly through a religious lens. Politics and geostrategy and geopolitics always comes next. I have a book that I believe in, the Holy Quran. It tells me in chapter 5, verse 20 onwards, that God had ordered his prophet Moses to take the Jews and enter the land of Israel and to never leave. Now, for me, that is a land title in my holy book, telling me that the land, according to God's wishes, belongs to the Jewish people. Thank you. But which basically means that the borders of Israel today are not inclusive of the entire Holy Land. So Hamas should be very happy that Israel gave them, or didn't give them, but you know, the claim is not for more land and that the borders are where they are, whereas the Quran speaks of land that goes all the way down to Egypt and includes many rivers and waters, and that is known as the Blessed Land. And so my view is that firstly, you have minorities in Israel, and for the Muslims, you're looking at nearly 20% of the population, 18% of the population in Israel are Muslims, and it is absolutely disgusting that these Muslims are ignored. They're ignored by the Muslim world, largely by the Muslim world leaders, because they are having a wonderful lifestyle. They have their rights. They live in total peace. And when Hamas fires rockets, it fires it at them as well, because they're also citizens living in Israel. But nobody wants to speak about their lifestyle, and nobody wants to speak about why they insist on living in Israel when they have Israeli passports. You can travel to many countries, right? At least in Europe. So I think the reality speaks for itself.
Thank you. Père Desbois.
Father Desbois, for Christians in Israel.
It's a complicated question. There is a huge diversity in Israel of Christians. It's very different if you say, from where? Do you speak of the Christian living in Beersheba, in Haifa, in Yafo, in Jerusalem, in Nazareth? It's completely different. So I would say it's a strong potential. Nobody pays attention. The patriarch of the Catholic Church in Jerusalem, who is collecting all the Catholics from Jordan and from Israel, he doesn't speak Arabic, he speaks only Hebrew, because he studied in Ratzofim. And so there is a huge potential. And me, I follow since the beginnings, when I arrived in Israel a long time ago, 30 years ago, the first time I was in Haifa. And I was hosted by Christians living in Haifa, speaking Hebrew and working in Israel with a normal job. And we never felt any aggression. So I would say it's a potential, but it's also something that we have to help, because I also to criticize a little bit Israel. And I'm a goy, you know. And so, no choice. And so I would say the young Jews from now, the young Israeli, some of them have no idea what is a Christian. If you go today to a yeshiva in Nebrak or in Jerusalem, they don't have an idea what is a Catholic sister, what is a priest, and what is all this system. I will tell you, to finish, a funny joke. Oh. I was with the journalist when Pope John Paul II came, and I had to coordinate the journalist in Yad Vashem when he came. And most of the journalists around me were Israeli, and I speak Hebrew, and they didn't understand anything about the Pope was doing. They say, why he has a cross like that? What he says that? Why he says that? So I understood it's a mystery. So I say Israel have to play good card with the Christian. They are not anti-Israeli, but a young generation have to know them and to support them. And reciprocally, the young Christian have to know Israel of today, not the Israel of the kibbutz. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So it's for sure that only good willing people are going to help. And definitely come very often and tell us jokes. Thank you very much.